And this is why I have decided to discuss it with you. It's a verification of Freud's theories. It's a sort of illustration of all the points on so many chapters that Freud discussed throughout his life. Right. I hope most of you have seen the film. I'm going to give you a short story of it so that you know exactly what it's all about. It's a gentleman who's been living at his wife's expense, and already we have a relationship between mother and child, a man kept by women, and all the men in there except the hero and the inspector, of course, are like this, the two men, I mean. Then he hires a murderer, somebody to kill his wife, against money. So money goes again at the excrement, money goes in between the two murderers. The murderer is split in two, as in a dream, as I will show. And then the murderer comes in, thanks to a key, which I will discuss later on, and which is, to me, the fundamental symbol of that story. So the murderer comes in, hides behind the curtain, tries to strangle the woman. He doesn't manage to do so, and the woman kills him with scissors, and we shall see that in a moment. So that the first attempt of the husband, who is symbolically something else, as I will show, fails, so he tries a second attempt by making sure that his wife will be sentenced for the murder of the aggressor, for the murder of the thief. And he's almost about to succeed when, of course, Chief Inspector Hubbard, a good father image or a good grandfather image, whatever you like, comes in and finds out that there's been a sort of exchange of keys, and this is, of course, very funny. I will try to explain this. And so because of the keys, because of the way keys are handled by the murderer, he fails, and in the end, the lover of the lady goes out with her happily after, and the bad husband or the bad father is dismissed. That's the story. Okay, so let's begin with the first few shots of the film in 65 seconds. Oh, no, I forgot. I have something to say. The scenario is not Hitchcock's. Funnily enough, the scenario is from a play by a man called Frederick Knott, K-N-O-T-T, and Hitchcock kept most of the dialogue really to a point, except for the first few pages and the first last page. They both end in the same way, but Hitchcock cut a bit. It's Frederick Knott's dialogue. So that I am not going to analyze Hitchcock, I'm not going to analyze Frederick Knott, who is dead and is not asking me to do so. But I will just analyze what is besides subject, which is general, which is universal, which can be recognized by all subjects, that is to say, Freud's theory, illustrated by this film. So it's not, Hitchcock did not write a story, but of course he accepted to do the film, or decided to do the film, and my idea is that he showed himself a marvelous reader of that film, not interpreting it. I don't think he was an interpreter, or even though he knew psychoanalysis, but his reading is so intelligent that really the illustration on film is marvelous. Right, now let's begin with the first 65 seconds of the film. Please, if the gentleman is there.
The law, the story about justice, about being punished. Arrival of another. The lover arrives on Queen Mary. until we get to the murder scene in a moment. So, what is marvelous about this film as an illustration, as you've seen it in 65 seconds, Hitchcock shows you not everything, because the second part of the movie is about keys, which I will discuss at length. So that we have a movie about what? A triangle. And of course, what I am trying to say is that this film, as I said, a beautiful illustration of Freud's theories, illustrates two or three points in Freud. The first is that literature has a structure of the dream. Cinema has a structure of the dream. And I will try to show this. For instance, when one character is split into two, a symbol character is split into two, there are two murderers. Exactly as in a dream, you just skip from one character to the other. And so it shows you that dream is the key of desire. That's where we show our desire, exactly as we do in literature and film, but with the same structure. The second point is, of course, that not only is literature like a dream, and so now I'll show that a bit, also that something that is fundamental in psychoanalysis is the triangular structure. Husband, wife, lover, or rather, and it's on the blackboard, father, mother, and child. And the child is prevented from obtaining the object, who is the mother, whether the child is a girl or a boy. If you don't like the triangle, you just go to the other side of the board and you have the Lacanian sign of subject, incomplete subject, the bar, which is the prohibition, and then object little a. So that, again, this is a triangle. You see, you have subject, you have the bar, and you have object. It's the same thing, it's the same structure. So the triangular structure is the basis of that film. As we saw in 65 seconds, husband, breakfast, and boyfriend. What I didn't say is that in this breakfast scene, the husband throws salt over the shoulder, which is probably a sign that this is going to be tragic, and he tries to maybe conjure his destiny, and also that he has a letter in his hand. This story is built over four symbols. The letter, and here you can't help thinking of Garpo. I mean, I'm sure that Frederick Knott, whom I don't know, and I have not read anything except his play, knew about the purloined letter, because this film is also about a purloined, that is to say a stolen letter, which is much more than a letter, which is a phallic letter, as in Lacan's tale of the purloined letter. The husband steals the letter and uses it to blackmail his wife, not of course under his name, but pretend that somebody ran, so that to frighten his wife, by thanks to the letter, because the letter was saying that she was in love with somebody else. Again, the triangle. So we have the letter, which is a fundamental symbol. The second symbol, of course, is a money that goes from the murderer, one half of the murderer, to the other half of the murderer, as in a dream, two characters for one meaning. And then the third symbol is are keys. And not any keys, but a latch key, which will be hidden, and this is very important. And this key is always, from the point of view of the lady, everybody has a key, as you will see. There are two keys, for men and for women, again. And this, again, is very Freudian, because the film is also about the difference between the sexes, sexual difference. Exactly in a very strictly Freudian way. So the key is always in the bag. I mean, you understand the bag, the woman of the body of the womb, and so on. The key and the letter were in the bag. And so you see the husband stole this, so that's already a castration, a punishment of the woman, a castration of the woman, taking the key from her, taking the letter from her, and this is why he will be destroyed, he will be punished, because he has infringed a normal state of things of women on one side and men on the other.
Okay, so that's the story, and that's the symbols, and now we can look at the details of the story. And of course, the most important thing in the first part, the film is divided in two parts. The first part is something very Freudian, the primal scene. It's a film founded on the primal scene. What is the primal scene? It is what you see in Vertigo and what you see in Rear Window. A child watching or imagining his parents making love. Again, the triangle, which is of course the structure, fundamental structure of that film, that play. So, because here we are going to attend, we're going to look at a primal scene, fundamental, even the husband will listen to it while it takes place. You see, you'll be the witness of what happens. And this primal scene is, of course, the man, the murderer, trying to strangle the woman. Strangling, castration is not too far. Unfortunately, this primal scene will fail for the husband, for the father, the wicked father husband, because the lady will kill her murderer. And how will she kill it? You're going to see this in 2 minutes. She'll kill it with stabbing something into her back. And what this something is, a pair of scissors, needless to say. Again, we are talking about castration, you see. So you get the scene. Now we can look at the primal scene, which is a tremendously well done and well understood primal scene. Whether it's got new or not, I don't know, but it's marvelous. And very fine. Yes? This is calling, waking up the wife, so that she crosses the door and goes to the place where she can be assaulted. He thinks, well, he's not going to ring, I'm leaving. And then it rings. So he comes back behind the curtain. She, very beautiful, in a lovely dress, nice dress, very desirable. She, like the mother, she comes to the phone.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Suspense?
Hello?
Point of view of the murderer?
Hello?
Hello?
Child watching the scene?
Hello?
Drama. It's not a tragedy, it's a drama. You'll see why.
sue the husband as failed. Bloody hell, what shall I do? He comes back home, and finally, of course, second part of his plot, he repeats the aggression, the castration of the lady, by helping to the police to accuse her of the murder. How does he do it? Because of a letter, the letter of the lover. He has put the letter in the pocket of the dead man's on the floor, so that the police find the letter, on which, of course, the fingerprints were, because he had taken that precaution. So the police said, well, he was blackmailing you, and you killed him. You're guilty, and you're going to be sentenced to death, which you will be almost at the end of the day. So the husband wins the second round. He lost the first assault. He wins the second assault. The lady is castrated. That's the first part of the movie. The second part is all about keys. And of course, keys are a fundamental item in this film. I don't have time to give you the dialogue, but it's beautiful. The inspector says, how many keys are there? Answer, there are only two keys. My husband has his own on him, and I have mine in my bag. Okay, this is a sexual difference, you see? And okay, so, well, I can read a couple of things. So why is the lady accused? She is accused because the police has found that the murderer could not have come from the garden door. He had to come in through the door. How did he get in? So nobody understands. And of course, let me tell you how he got in. As you may remember, he got in because the husband had hidden the key under the floor carpet, the stairs carpet. Now, I don't want to go too far, but if we are in analysis, we can try. Look at this key under the carpet. It's a lady's key. Something sexual about it. My association is that this is the clitoris, and that it would hidden, and it's shown. Of course, Hitchcock shows you so the key under the carpet. Okay, so the police says, if he got in with the door, she must have opened to him. And of course, then we have an idea of what the symbolical meaning of the lady's key is. It's not a key which penetrates. It's a key which permits entrance. It's very feminine. It's a key, it's sexual, it's phallic, but it's phallic in the role of the lady. She lets him. She didn't let him, but I mean, it's something that permits penetration. Right, that's the lady's key, which is under the door, under the carpet, under his hood, like a clitoris. Right, so this is why she's sentenced, because she must have let him in. Okay, so then comes the savior. Again, as in a dream, the savior is composed of two figures. The lover, who is the writing of detective novels, and very clever, and he thinks that the key must have been hidden somewhere. But of course he doesn't know where. He tries, he's very near the truth, he's very approaching the truth. And of course the other person is the benevolent father image, or the grandfather image, Chief Inspector Hubbard. So he's an actor I love, and we've seen him many times in film. And the Chief Inspector Hubbard has gone through as full of that, like the detective. But of course he has been lucky enough to find the key, which he has put back. And so now, how do we condemn, how will we catch the stealer of the key, the castrator of the lady? And we catch him, and the inspector catches him, because he's made one mistake. And the mistake is that when the body of the half murderer was on the ground, he searched his pockets and found a key. And he said, okay, he hasn't put the key back, so I'll take it. And phallic key, except that it's the phallus of a dead man. Remember that, we're going to explain that. So he takes the key, and he also takes and he puts the letter. So the police didn't find the key, found the letter, said the woman is guilty. Okay, but Hubbard, Chief Inspector Hubbard, thinks about all this, looks for the key, doesn't tell anyone, but find the key.
And so he wants, if he wants to save the lady, like Oedipus and the young, the lover who is in the place of Oedipus will also help. They arrange a mouse trap. They trap the murderer in this way. They, at one moment, if you've seen the film, maybe you didn't understand that little piece because it's not easy to understand. Inspector Hubbard comes in and he drops his own key. And he says, oh, what is this? Is it your key, sir? And the one says, no, I have got mine on me. Right. So he knew that, of course. So he said, a key, puts it in his raincoat. Being sure, then afterwards, he will exchange the raincoats. He does this to be sure that the murderer, the husband, goes out with a raincoat that has nothing in it. Not the key, because if he had the key, he would open with his own key. So he has taken the key, castrated the bad husband. He's taken his key, you see? And so, and so then the lady is sentenced to death. He's going to die tomorrow, to be hanged tomorrow, and so on and so on. This is about far-fetched, but we can accept that. It's all symbolical. And so the inspector manages to send the husband to the police station, where he's supposed to recover the bag with the wife's key. But in that bag, what we have, because the husband has put the key back into the bag. In that bag, what do we have? We don't have a masculine phallus. We have a masculine phallus of a dead man. That is to say, a no phallus, a zero phallus. It doesn't going to work. So the lady comes in. They make the lady come in. She has her bag. She's got a bag back from the police station. She tries to open the door. The key does not fit the lock. It's not the proper key. It's not the proper phallus. Why? Because it's the one, as I said, of a dead man. Okay. So it's not her. So we have to try it on the husband. And so same thing. They send the bag back to the police station, and they say to the husband, you should go and get your wife's affair at the police station, a key and books. And inside, they have put the wrong key, the key of the dead man, the dead phallus. Okay, so the husband comes in, tries the key, it doesn't work, goes out, says, what's the matter? He says, well, I understand. The other bugger put the key back, so it must still be on the stairs. So he goes back, takes the woman's key, what permits entrance, opens it, and of course, he's found out. Because how did you know that the key was there? And so that's almost the end. It's not quite the end, because the whole structure, the whole story is built from beginning, as you saw, husband, letter, which is a symbol of destiny, of course, but we can't go into that. So husband, letter, lover, one kiss, triangle, and then we get back to the triangle again. The detective novel, that is to say the child, goes away with the womb mother. And that's why we had Queen Mary. So that it's a beautiful dream. Completely unrealistic, because you don't marry your mother. When I was a kid, I remember that. And let me tell you, you'll be my analyst for once. When I was a kid, I remember that, because it's a really strong memory. I was about six, before six. I was playing, my father had a motorcycle. I was playing on a chair, put on the floor, and my mother was knitting or whatever, sewing nicely in a corner. And I remember this as if it's to this day. I said, quand je serai grand, je me marierai avec toi. When I grow up, I shall get married to you. I mean, well, even that's why I'm a Freudian. And so this is what happens. This film is built on this fantasy. I killed my father. The wicked father who has castrated my mother. Different. I must come back and then I should stop. And then, of course, this is what happened. The film is the story, is a dream about I get rid of my father and go home with my mother. And of course, On top of that, we have something very interesting on the difference between the sexes. There's a phallic key for the men and a phallic key for women, except that they are not the same, they don't have the same function, but they are both phallic in as much as they are sexual. Thank you.